David, you know, Paulson has really escaped the scrutiny that he deserves, hasn't he? I mean, this is a guy who, you call him the Bin Laden, the Bin Laden of Wall Street. And you know what? When I read your stuff, you almost have to conclude that that's the case. This is an ugly little character, isn't he?
Right. You know, I mean, when I say that and compare him to Bin Laden and call him like a financial terrorism network, I know it sounds silly to the average person. It sounds ridiculous. But when you actually look at the statistics and the devastation that has been caused, I mean, you could back this up, I mean, statistically speaking. So, yeah, he started in the Pentagon working for Nixon's first defense secretary, Melvin Laird.
Right.
He worked in his office, and then he was the assistant to Ehrlichman during the events of Watergate. And, of course, Ehrlichman was convicted for perjury and cover-up and sent to prison. And, you know, Paulson worked with him on a daily basis.
There's no way to say that Hank Paulson doesn't have a really shady background. You talked about Melvin Laird, for example. People have to understand why that's important. He worked for Melvin Laird. I mean, what does that mean? This has got a former defense secretary. What does that do to Paulson as he moves through his political career?
Well, I mean, if you look at U.S. intelligence, military industrial complex, I mean, when you're working with the people in the upper echelons, which Melvin Laird is,
he's
just a pillar of the military-industrial complex. He's also been a board member of SAIC, like we talked about in a previous interview.
Right.
I mean, he's just at the top of the U.S. intelligence.
So all that stays with Paulson is the point that I'm making. In other words, he's well-connected in the military-industrial complex. A lot of the things, and I know you've written on this. We'll talk about it in another interview, but that's where we start seeing Paulson is with Melvin Laird in the Pentagon. Then he goes to John Ehrlichman working in the Nixon administration. Shady, shady, shady Watergate connections. We know that, for example, you remember him through the where he changes the Commodities Modernization Act. Talk about how that just had the first. The first step towards what he did to us.
Well, after his disgraced exit from the Watergate scandal in the political world, he joined Goldman Sachs, and he rose up the ranks of Goldman Sachs, eventually in 1999 forcing out John Corzine as CEO.
Right.
He actually led an internal revolt against Corzine to get him out.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then Paulson's first order of business was coming out strongly for the Commodities Modernization Act, which gave birth to the derivative floodgates, what Warren Buffett calls financial weapons of mass destruction.
It deregulated all of these hinky over-the-counter derivative deals, right?
Right.
In other words, government can't look at it. Government can't get involved. It's no law and order with derivatives at the point that Paulson accomplished that, correct?
Right. It opened the floodgates. That was part one of what Paulson did to lead to the crisis. Part two, and very significant, is in 2004, he led the Gang of Five CEOs that went to the Securities Exchange Commission and got them to get rid of the net capital rule. Now, the net capital rule held derivatives in check to a certain extent because it said that you couldn't place risk and bets if you didn't have the assets to back them up.
The law was that a bank, for example, had to have assets to do a certain percentage of assets to do a certain percentage of business. There was a ratio that was established.
Right.
With this, the net capital rule, basically they just got rid of it as far as these derivatives were concerned, companies that were exchanging these derivatives, and there were no laws.
Right. I mean, so before the net capital rule, it basically said, you know, you can go to Vegas and you can bet your house, but you can't bet more than your house because that's all you own.
Right.
But with the net capital rule out of the way, then all of a sudden the derivative were unleashed, and now they were betting their house and everyone else's house on these crazy bets and these credit default swaps.
And lying to them while they're doing it, saying, yeah, it's safe. Yeah, we've looked into it. Yeah, Moody's looked into it. They have good ratings. Yeah, don't worry about it. As a matter of fact, later we find out that part of the time that was going on, they were getting rid of theirs because they knew it was complete garbage that was going to cost them money. One thing that is very clear is Hank Paulson starts off, in his career, he's basically intern kind of assistant to Ehrlichman. Let's not overstate what he was to John Ehrlichman in the Watergate. He was a go-to guy for John Ehrlichman, who went to prison for the Watergate scandal. Ehrlichman was right there with Paulson when all this was going on. So when his buddy goes to prison, or his the guy he works for goes to prison, Paulson then ends up over with Goldman Sachs and cashes out. Before it's all over, before Paulson goes to the U.S. Treasury, moves to the U.S. Treasury, he's cashed in $700 million that he has made in scams, scams that relate to derivative cases, scams that come from his success in deregulating the Commodities Modernization Act, or doing away with it, scams that came out of him doing away with the net capital rule, scams that came out of ICE, the ICE organization. The ICE organization is one of those things that most people don't even know what the hell it is. They don't even know why it's costing the American consumer so much. And so out of that, Hank Paulson, out of ICE, out of his hustle on the Commodities Modernization Act, after his hustle on net capital rule, he comes out with $700 million. And then what do? We put him in charge of America's money, right? Tell us about that.
Right. So then Bush and Cheney declare him basically the czar of the economy, giving him almost complete control to fix the mess that he created and profited from.
Right. And that Goldman Sachs gave so much money to the Republicans. JP gave so much money. I mean, this was the payoff. Bring the little, freak in and let him now mess with the American money, right? It's a payoff.
As soon as he was put into place, he hires, without congressional approval, several top Goldman executives to basically write the bailout, oversee the TARP operation. I mean, it was insane. Edward Liddy, who Paulson made CEO of AIG, before he made him CEO of AIG, Edward Liddy was a board member of Hank Paulson's, and he was the board member overseeing the audit committee at Goldman Sachs, which he was intimately involved in creating all the CDO, credit default obligations, that they insured through AIG.
Right, exactly, so exactly.
He was the key player in the AIG bailout, and without the AIG bailout, Goldman Sachs would have collapsed as a result of their own Ponzi scheme.
Okay, now let's go back here a second. Very clear, Paulson, after creating all the stuff we just talked about, moves in the U.S. government. He now has his inside guy in charge of AIG, which basically gives cover to his old company, Goldman Sachs. I mean, that's what's happening. At the same time, though, he assassinates Bear Stearns and he assassinates the Lehman Brothers.
These are huge moves. I try to explain this to people by using a baseball metaphor. Okay, imagine if George Steinbrenner, the owner of the New York Yankees, one day was declared commissioner of Major League Baseball. And what does he do as commissioner of Major League Baseball? He decides he doesn't want the Boston Red Sox in the league anymore, and he kicks them out. That's what happened with Lehman Brothers. Mm-hmm. And then he looks at the New York Mets and says, I don't want you around anymore either.
Because I want to win the pennant.
Right. And then he destroys Bear Stearns. They have a run on Bear Stearns. Their stock prices drop to $2. And then J.P. Morgan can swoop in and snatch up Bear Stearns for fire sale price.
Now, you know what's most incredible about all this is the little freak has not been indicted. That's the most bothersome thing about this conversation.
Exactly.
Is he took his $700 million. He just created apocalypse for the American economy.
This man is personally responsible for the theft of trillions of dollars, not just through the bailout, but through market manipulation on the grandest scale.
Yeah, and he's walking around out there like everything's okay. Like this story you just told, if you lined up 10 people, none of them would know the story, probably. I mean, certainly, our listeners might because they keep up with what's going on. But the average, they don't even know who the hell Hank Paulson is. He's this little creep that did all of this, has not been indicted, has not even been investigated in any meaningful way. And he's still walking around, the Madoffs are in prison. This guy should be in prison with the Madoff type.